This is the next in our series of videos covering the 32 teams, their drafts, the caps are looking at undrafted free agent signings, and the Colts are a team that has a lot of very intriguing young pieces and one intriguing old piece. I'll start with their dead money situation. T-Lock Hilton's $2.3 million against the cap, Eric Fisher's $2 million against the cap, Brock Descendant's $934,355 against the cap, Jack Doyle's $3.8 million against the cap, Jacob Eason is $366,132 million against the cap, $730,000 against the cap, Sean Davis, $230,000. Following two, Rogers, Gavin Marvell, Calvin III, is $164,000. And $82 in his cap, so dead cap of only $6,813,072 cap. So their big cap numbers are Matt Ryan, whose cap number is $18,075,880. DeVore's Buckner is $16 million cap this year. Quentin Nelson is $13,754,000 against the cap and worth every penny. Monique Noah is $13 million against the cap. Brady Smith is $11,567,000 against the cap. Darius Smith is $11,116,000 against the cap. And a bargain at that. Rovers do it $10,625,000 against the cap. Ryan Blade $9.75 million against the cap. And Stephon Gilmore is $7.75 million against the cap. And Kenny Moore is $6.75 million against the cap. Once again, masterful work to some extent by the front office there. We'll talk about the man himself in a moment. Total cap liabilities of $226,202,178 and $13,226,295 still available, reallocated. And they're slightly defense heavy, about a little over $111 million is on the defensive side and a little over $102 million on the offensive side. And to talk a little bit about the philosophy at work and the man sort of running the show for them at this point, it's interesting to take a look at Christopher R., like Chris Ballard, born in Galveston, Texas, on the beautiful Gulf, and grew up both in Texas and Wisconsin, ended up finishing up in Wisconsin and goes on to play football. First, was a quarterback in high school, very good quarterback in high school, not as good collegiate level, moves the wide receiver, doesn't play a lot, but contributes, and then becomes a history teacher at Hitchcock Junior High School, also helps out with the football team, and one of his former coaches mentions him to a coach, in fact, he should be the Hall of Fame, but isn't yet, Ron Harn, who was a terrific coach at the D2 level. Ron Harn hires him, he coaches wide receivers, and later coaches in the secondary and on defense, and while he was there, he joined Jerry Angelo's scouting staff. After that, he joined Jerry Angelo's scouting staff for the Bears in 2001. In 2012, gets promoted and becomes Chicago's director of professional scouting and stays there for a season and then moves on to the Chiefs and works very closely with John Dorsey and makes some very sort of gutsy moves-wise. Gets there, they're 2-14 in 2012, and then turned it around. They have 4 consecutive winning seasons, 3 playoff appearances, and eventually an AFC West title. 43-21 over those seasons, and eventually becomes director of player personnel, stays there until the end of 2014, gets promoted to director of football operations, and stays there in 2016, and then obviously from there he becomes the general manager, obviously, with the Colts. But while he was there, he was instrumental, apparently, in their selecting Marcus Peters, a very controversial pick, as you might remember, if you were in draft Twitter around that time, at Washington, got suspended for a fight at the Fight Hunger Bowl. Also, he was late turning the final four class, he headbutted Eastern Washington receiver, he refused to let, you know, to brought calm down where everybody says the coach, threw his helmet and gloves, and then also apparently had a failed drug test from marijuana in 2011. So both a mix of yellow and red flags in his past, but Ballard seemed really convinced he was worth it, and they took him, and obviously he's been a very good player. Then, once again, during the playoffs in 2016, Ballard was introduced to the general manager of the Colts. He immediately begins changing the lineup. Four previous starters are moved on from. And of course, the reason the Briggs is considered a failure is almost not entirely, but largely because of his failure to protect Andrew Luck. So he quickly begins to move on that. A little side note, sort of following the steps of his mentor, they previously had thought they had Josh Daniels signed to a agreement in principle, I think is the term. And then, like his, like the master, he then withdraws and goes back to his old home. So you end up getting Frank Wright, and it's one of those things where he sort of fell up into a good situation, you know, when Josh Daniels ends up not coming, when he went to check the dime. And they immediately begin doing well. Of course, Quentin Nelson and Darius Leonard were all pro first team, and as immediately, and the first third rookie teammates to do so since 1965, and only the second to do so in NFL history, I believe, going back obviously to the Bears draft, I believe it would be both Gail Sayers and Dick Butkus. So that's not a bad couple of guys to, you know, be compared to. He was the executive of the year in 2018 of the Football Writers of America. Now, looking at the depth chart, the guys are brought in where they fit in. Well, Michael Pittman Jr. and Desmond Patman, Austin Dillon, all probably safe. But Alec Pierce and Michael Strahan are guys who have size and speed. They also brought in Kakua Crawford, Samson Nakua, Kakua Crawford, and Samson Nakua, who has two brothers who also were pretty good football players, and Ethan Fernia. Fernia is one of those guys who's like a lighter, faster, but less polished and less productive version of Alec Dimitri Felton. Played both running back and wide receiver, you know, slot, and all kinds of things at his time in UCLA, but was a humble walk-on and never really produced a lot, but he could stick on special teams with a chance. Michael Young is another guy who's a shot at the slot. Paris Campbell, PPQT, I think they're both safe, but maybe DeMichael Harris and he'll battle it out for a spot. Obviously, I think that Pierce sees the field early and often. I think Pittman, you know, once again, is a budding superstar. Paris Campbell is probably the guy who sort of has the best chance to not hold on to the spot. Either QT, Harris, Young, or even Finney, who I don't think, I think he's a special team guy, he needs a stick. They obviously drafted the very athletic but older tackle from Central Michigan, Bernhard, Raimann, and he's going to see the field as much as better than at least a swing between left and left tackle. And they also really like Brian Dunham. How much do I like Brian Dunham? He's from Connecticut. They guaranteed him the signing bonus of $175,000 for running back in free agent. That's how much they like him. Lots of guys who get drafted late don't get that much in signing bonus. So he's virtually guaranteed to make the team. And if not on the 53, definitely in practice draft, right? Because he makes the 53. They put in as a tight end as well. Ogletree and Johnny Woods are both very large and pretty good athletes. Ogletree from Youngstown State and Johnny Woods, Oklahoma State by way of Virginia, or Virginia by way of Oklahoma State, Mary, I think of it. And they brought in one quarterback, Jack Cohn, and I don't hate the idea of him being in, and he's learning to be James Morgan and Sam Ellinger. Could he beat out one of those two? Possibly, but they'll be readdressing the quarterback position. I don't think any of the quarterbacks not named Matt Ryan should be starting in an NFL game. And then the running back position is fascinating. Obviously, they have very defined roles in the first few guys. Jonathan Taylor is one of the real bell cow backs left. In your mind, is the receiving back, third down back, you know, can move around, space player. Philip Lindsay can do a bit of everything. And then Deion Jackson's the guy who's fighting off Devontae Price, guy who really like. I'm going to spend some time on Devontae Price. Devontae Price and CJ Verdell are two really interesting running backs. They're sort of not opposites, but they're definitely different. So the older and taller back is Devontae Price. 6'1", 3'8", got down to 198 at one point, but he played about 211, 212 most of his football career. You know, probably lost more run times, but he can play probably above 215 and still be really effective. Probably more like a mid 4.4, if you're in 4.38, but due to the weight he dropped, at least in part. 6 yards a carry on 369 career attempts and 34 inch vertical, 9-10 broad. He has some size, he has some speed. You know, people worry a little about him being a little stiff, a little upright. I don't worry about that. There's lots of successful guys you know, I mean, you know what guys like, Latavius Murray, but he's better than Latavius Murray. I think Latavius Murray is sort of almost be not disappointing as that, but I think he has a chance to be better, I put it that way. And they also bring in CJ Bedell. And so, you know, obviously Jordan Wilkins is gone, they have some other running backs they like, but other than the top two, nobody else is assured Deion Jackson is going to fight these guys off. 5'7", 202, people thought Verdell was faster than he was. I always thought he was more like Jaquiz Rogers than he was like a guy like MJD. 2900 vert, but a little concerning, 9'10 broad, not impressive. So he's a not terribly explosive, but tough little running back. I mentioned Vandermeer. And I think Chris Fowler, because of what he, his experience with a guy like Derek Bowles, and he's not Bowles, I mean, Bowles is a better player, but he sees some of that in a guy like Vandermeer. 6'6", 307, or almost 6'6", 307. 39 games played, 34 of them starts at left tackle, and like I said, they really like him. 5'27" in the 40, and I've got things over at some big press, and I really long on to the 35 and 8 an inch. Also, had 30.5 in vert, 9.4 broad, short total 4.5 seconds, 3 comes 7.5 seconds. And like I said, Strasser comes from, among other places, the Broncos. He's an aggressive angle setting as opposed to, you know, the more popular vertical stuff. And he developed here at Bowles. Here's Bowles' combine number, 6'5", 297, 4.95, really fast, 4.95, 40. 28 inch vertical, like very close together, in fact, slight edge to down about there. 17.9 free cone, edge back to Bowles. Terrific athlete. 4.55 short shuttle, so the short shuttle time are very good. 4.5 versus 4.55 for Bowles. Bowles is more polished, both in his hands and feet. And, but yeah, similar explosive, similar agility, and Bowles is faster. Bowles, of course, is faster. And Vandermeer's a highly prized UDFA. Here's some other UDFAs I think actually have a shot to make the 53, or worst case, practice squad. Dallas Ballard, Pittsburgh State. Like, I'm older past that, so he's 25 very soon. But he has size, right? 60.5 inch, 195 pounds, returned 2 kicks per touchdown, and he could be potentially special. We're talking about a guy that has a, you know, 12 or 11, like almost 13, almost like 12, 11, 12 feet, 11 inch broadband. That's, you know, in the top 3 since we've been keeping track. Top 3%, not top 3. 4.43 40, which is really good for guys. Size 4.34 shuttle run, 6.98 three cone, 17 kick returns, the final 17 yards of 2 touchdowns, 33.7 yards per kick return. Broke the record of guess who? Ron Brown also kicked the kick, so that's the school record. JoJo Doman from Nebraska, right? Some people thought he'd be drafted. I thought he had a very good chance to go anywhere from the late fifth onward. You know, he fits a also another older player, which is by way of method, because he's 25 soon. But he's got decent speed, 4.3, in fact, 4.60, very good. 15 bench reps, 34.5 inch broad, 9.11 short shuttle, 4.32 in the short shuttle, and 6.88, really good. They have a type, right? Because they took a bunch of linebackers who are either taller or shorter or older or younger version of each other. And they got Forrest Myers and Villanova. Terrific player. Made my all underappreciated team. He's terrific. Mike linebacker at Villanova. He got special team play, 4.69 to 40, 26. He's really good for that. That size. But a 9.10 broad, 4.2 short total, 7.26 three times, which is solid. 112 tackles, 5.5 tackles lost, 2.5 sacks, and recovered a fumble. And the last two, right, taller and shorter versions of these same people, James Dawson, right? Terrific player from Clemson, another 6-year guy, so another 8-year player, 5'11", 7'8", 228, 4'7", 240, so the slowest of the guys, but still not slow. 26 bench reps, 34-inch vertical, 9'6 broad, 4'3", 3'3", 6'9", 6". That's a way better short cover for a linebacker. And then, maybe the most intriguing of the bunch is Dylan Weatherford. High school quarterback, who also plays some safety, comes to Miami, Ohio, plays both safety and a little linebacker, and, you know, had a visit at their local pro day with the Colts. He's 6'4", 224, he's 4'6", flat, 21 reps, 6'25", 36 inch vert, 9'9", broad, 4'3", 3'4", so on, a really great 3-point, like 6'9", 3, 3-point. And here's a guy who's sort of a freebie for them, and I'll mention one other guy after him. Marcel Dabo from Germany, and just, you know, 22 and 5 months or so years old, 4.52 at a special participant combine for, like, the International Player Pathway Program. He played in Germany, was the Rookie of the Year, in fact, in the European League of Football for the Stuttgart Stage. About 6 feet, 210 pounds, 11 football, 19 reps at the bench press, and has played both safety and corner, mostly corner, a little bit of nickel, but since they sort of keep him around for free for a while because of the National Pathway Program, he's going to be kept around at least through training camp. The last thing we'll talk about, I'll mention it was in passing, but that's not what you focus on. It's another thing where I'm pretty sure age is the only reason he wasn't drafted. Scott Pax is yet another super senior. But 6'1", 251, surprisingly, this is surprising because the guy started his career in Miami, he was a four-star recruit, so you may not say surprisingly. But people, I don't know why people aren't talking about Scott Pax. I think he has a really good chance to make the team. And if you look at the Colts' depth chart, they have pretty heavy. Tyquan Lewis, this guy just said, Ben Benninger, we'll see. Obviously, behind Nick Rockley is safe. Vadeo Olivo, Cameron Klein, Colin Lick. I mean, Colin Lick is another undrafted free agent. I think Scott Patrick makes it. I'll be somewhat surprised if he doesn't. Curtis Brooks, who I know he's just raving about, is going to be in the mix amongst the D-tackles. Nick Cross is going to play. Maybe even beats out Tyree Lewis for strong safety. We'll see. We're talking about Johnny Woods. I could see him, if not starting, at least being their number two tight end, and I think he starts every sooner or later. But amongst the undrafted free agents, who, other than the ones I just mentioned, I think I'll have a chance to make it, is Scott Patrick. He's a really good athlete. Like, I think people slept on him, so he's right. But productive, 19 and a half, tackles for loss, 10 and a half sacks. You know, like I said, played originally tight end when he came to Miami, but look, strong guy, 29 reps, right? He's kind of putting him down to 29 reps, 4.68 in the 40, despite having hamstring tightness, 32 and a half inch for 9-11 blood. I think those numbers probably would be a little higher than the hamstring. I would be very surprised if this team, he doesn't need this team, I promise you, he would make another team. And there's some other, they have a lot of players, they're like 22 in total, on a good team. But they believe clearly in competition. They want to take a look at a lot of guys, and this could be a really good year for the Colts. They're sort of a, for me, a